Thank you very much, and good morning, everyone, and welcome to the study of the Desire of Ages. Before we do that, we'll have a word of prayer, and then we'll all sing a song before we then jump onto the study. Let us pray. Father in heaven, it is such a privilege to begin this day in your presence. Thank you, Father, for the prayers that have gone up. We pray and believe that the Holy Spirit has those prayers have reached your presence and they are a sweet incense before you. And we thank you, Lord, for hearing and answering all the prayers, not according to our will, but according to yours. We also thank you, Lord, for the reminder that we've just heard of your soon coming, of the signs that are fulfilling even before our very eyes. Thank you, Father, because you've called us your friends, and you tell your friends what is going to happen. Soften our hearts so that this information will not be just a head knowledge, but that our lives will be transformed and we will live lives that are worthy of the calling with which we've been called. Now, as we open the inspired book, The Desire of Ages, I pray, Lord, for the Holy Spirit to be in our midst, to teach us and to convert us, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Okay, so the song we are going to sing today is hymn number 180 in the SDA hymnal, "All Listen to the Wondrous Story." And I'm going to share the music so that we can all fill our homes with music, with songs of praise.
From eternal.
Amen.
Welcome once again to our study of the Desire of Ages. Thank you in advance, Elder Desire, for sharing this screen. We are on chapter 25, The Call by the Sea. And just to recap on yesterday's study, it started with a description of one early morning in the life of Jesus. The disciples are in their fishing boats after a night of fruitless toil. And we see Jesus going to the waterside to get some quiet rest from the multitude that was following him day after day. And so Jesus steps into Peter's fishing boat and he asks him to pull out a little from the shore. Really to escape the pressure of the multitude, but to still be where he could be heard. And Sister White describes the scene like this. I think this is, paragraph 244.2. She says, because now he's on the lake, a little from the shore and there are multitudes around him. It says, the lake, the mountains, the spreading fields, the sunlight flooding the earth, all furnished objects to illustrate his lessons and impress upon the mind. And no lesson of Christ fell fruitless. Every message from his lips came to some soul as the word of eternal life. This is where we ended yesterday. And unless there are some comments or any thoughts anyone might want to share on yesterday's study, we shall continue. I'll just pause for a moment. Okay. I'll ask somebody to read the next paragraph. I think the next paragraph, but for the item in italics, I'll ask them. I'll actually read the item in italics because it is in the RV and it doesn't really convey the message as it should. I'll read it in the New King James. That's a quotation in Isaiah 9, verse 1 and 2. So I'll ask a reader to read the first, or maybe let me read everything so that at least there's no confusion. It says, every moment added to the multitude upon the shore. I mean, these are the people who are coming to listen to Jesus. And then it says, aged men leaning upon their staffs, hardy peasants from the hills, fishermen from their toil on the lake, merchants and rabbis, the rich and learned, old and young, bringing their sick and suffering ones, they pressed to hear the words of the divine teacher. To such scenes as this, the prophets had looked forward, and they wrote. Okay, I will read this prophecy in Isaiah. I'll read it in the King James Version, because it's talking about the coming of the Prince of Peace. She says, Isaiah 9, verses 1 and 2. It says, "Nevertheless, the dimness shall not be such as was in her vexation, when at the first he lightly afflicted the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, and afterward did more grievously afflict her by way of the sea beyond the Jordan, in Galilee of the nations." Verse 2. "The people that walked in darkness have seen a great light, and they that dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them hath the light shined." So this was a prophecy about when Jesus comes, that the people who walked in darkness, they will see a great light, even those who dwell in the land of the shadow of death, the light was shined upon them. In Patriarchs and Prophets, you know, Sister White comments about verse 2, about this great light shining, paragraphs 687 and 688. She says, "For centuries preceding Christ's first advent, darkness covered the earth, and gross darkness the people. Satan was throwing his hellish shadow athwart the pathway of men, that he might prevent them from gaining a knowledge of God and of the future world. Multitudes were sitting in the shadow of death. Their only hope was for this gloom to be lifted, that God might be revealed." And so at this riverside scene, we see Jesus, this prophecy coming, being fulfilled in Jesus explaining to the people, which really is the reason why so many were flocking around him. At the crack of dawn, I mean, people were there following him, ready to listen to what he had to say. I'll just pause there for a moment for any reflections on what we have just looked at. These two paragraphs, 1 and 2 of Desire of Ages.
Just a quick comment, Sister Martha. Good morning. Happy Sabbath, everyone. Sorry, I didn't raise my hand.
That's fine. Thank you. Go ahead.
Yes, I was just looking at that first paragraph there. Just looking at the content, or rather the audience, that was there whenever Jesus was delivering a sermon or a teaching. It says every moment added to the multitude upon the shore. Every moment was important. You know, it's like like what the Pharisees said when they were giving back the report. Said no man ever spoke like this man. This was the first time that ever felt the power of the Word of God. They had never appreciated the Word as they did now when it was being exposed. You know, he was a great exposer of the truth, Jesus. I mean, he is the truth himself. Think of the word. The word is Jesus in print, you would say. So there's, I mean, I can only imagine how beautiful it must have been to sit in that audience, listening to the divine teacher speaking. He says, aged men leaning upon their staff, hardy peasants from hills, fishermen. And you can see that there was all classes of people listening to the message. It was for all. You also have merchants, you also have rabbis, rich, learned, old and young. You have those who were sick, the blind, they were all there. And my question is, what attracted all these people to this place? Because wherever he was, they would throng after him. Now, this is the sort of way we should be doing evangelism.
Right.
If you notice, when you're reading that quotation there, Sister Martha, from Isaiah chapter 9, notice that there was a part where it was saying he was also going to speak to the Gentiles or to the nations. Now, it's interesting that the word Gentiles there in KJV is nations. Because the Jews, remember, they thought that this message was for them. They thought that the privileges of God were for them and them only. But when Jesus came, I mean, this has always been God's plan anyway, that through Abraham, all nations, again, that word nations, if you look at that word nations, refers to the Gentiles, to the Gentiles, because you have Israel, they were privileged to know God. But in Abraham, the Gentiles also were supposed to be blessed. And we see this same concept even when we come to the everlasting gospel. This is why the gospel that we are preaching now, according to Revelation chapter 14, is called the everlasting gospel. This gospel has always been. This is the gospel that was given to Adam. This is gospel that was given to Enoch, to Noah. It's for all people. It's for the Jews, it's for the Gentiles, it's for the Greek, it's for the nations, it's for all people, and that's why